ಓಮತ್ಯಾನ ಪಿಂಗಲಂಬಸ್ಯ ಜ್ಞಾನಾಂಜನ ಶಲಾಕಾಯ ಚಕ್ಷುರುನ್ಮಿಲಿತಮೇನ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. So thank you very much for joining today. I hope I'm audible to you. So okay, we are going to discuss about these limbs of bhakti, limbs of surrender. And yesterday we talked about the medical metaphor for understanding surrender, of how the six limbs, accepting the favorable and rejecting the unfavorable, that is similar to what a doctor will tell a patient to do. And that is if it's not a surgery, in most other treatment, it's often the patient has to do a lot of work. So in the six elements of surrender, the first two are quite active, dynamic. There are choices which we make in order to surrender. The next four are more of, so first two are actions, the next four are dispositions. We have faith in Krishna that he will protect us, because we have faith that he's already maintaining us. We see that. And then we understand that our whole being is to offer to be him, and we are worthless without him. Like a computer case screw fallen away from the computer. So today I'll speak on the first two elements. We'll see how it goes, and we'll understand the mood of surrender. I'll take examples primarily from the Bhagavatam to illustrate each of these elements, and I'll also talk something from the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. So anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam, these two are brought together. It's like, suppose we are guiding someone to do someone go there. So you will come to this turn. At this intersection, turn left and don't turn right. So in one sense, both of them are saying the same thing. So accept the favorable and reject the unfavorable. This kind of dual instruction to convey the same point, Krishna uses also repeatedly in the Bhagavad-Gita, where, for example, in 439 and 40, Krishna says, what is the destination of those who have faith? And 440, he says, what is the destination of those who don't have faith? Shraddha vallabhate jnanam tatpara sayateendriya jnanam labdva param shantim achirena adhigachati. If you have faith, you will acquire knowledge. If we attain knowledge of Krishna, if you are also sense controlled and we are dedicated, devoted to attaining that knowledge. On the other hand, if you don't have faith, agyascha shraddha dhanascha samshayatma vinashyati nayam lokosti na paro na sukham samshayatmanah. That if we do not have faith, then we will not be happy either in this world or in the next world. So basically, the point is that there is a contrast by which the instructions are given, this or that. So anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam. Now, if we consider that in the world, we are always making choices. Now, some choices are made even unconsciously. Say, for example, if you're sitting on a chair and you're a little uncomfortable, we might shift without even noticing that we are shifting. If we feel a little hot, we might just move toward the fan. And sometimes some things happen without even thinking about it. And some choices happen by conscious contemplation and decision. So now, what happens below our conscious awareness? That means we may be aware, but we don't consciously think about it. Or sometimes we are not even aware of it. But we are not investing our consciousness in doing it. So that has broadly two categories. There are impulses and there are instincts. In general, the word impulse is associated with something which is short-sighted and counterproductive. So somebody might have an impulse by which they might binge. They might binge eat, or they might splurge, spend a lot of money. So that's impulse. So impulse is something which we do without thinking and which is unintelligent. Whereas instinct is something which we do, again, without thinking, but we do, which is intelligent. So some people are good at certain things. That means if somebody comes to a house and they have good skills at home designing, interior decoration, they just say, okay, you move the sofa here, put this picture here, now just change the color of these drapes and your home will look much better. And somebody might have lived in that house for many months and they will not think about it. So basically, for us, both impulses and instincts are there. Now, when here Krishna is talking about surrender, Puranas are talking about surrender in terms of the six elements. He's talking about something which is done by conscious contemplation. So consciously, we choose what is favorable and consciously, we avoid that which is unfavorable. So simple example, suppose we come for a class and different devotees come to programs for different purposes. For some devotees, the class is the primary thing. They want to learn the philosophy. Some people, it might be the kirtan is what they look forward to. The class is something which they tolerate. For some people, it might just be being in a community together. It's just social, not socializing in a necessarily negative sense, but just being with people who care for them and whom they care for. That's what is the most important. So now suppose you are in the category where the class is very important for you. And suppose there's some other devotee for whom the socialization is very important. Then some devotees might just want to chat and they might not be very interested in focusing on the class. If we want to focus on the class, then anukulya sankalpa means we sit in a place where we will not get distracted. Where maybe the devotees sitting next to us are also not chatty or they don't get distracted. Generally, it is seen that in any meeting, if one person picks up their phone, everybody else wants to pick up their phone and see. So it's a group instinct. Of course, we can make notes on our phone also. But the point is that we are very affected by the things around us. So simply when we come for a class, anukulya sankalpa means we try to be in the situation where we can have maximum concentration. And pratikulya varjanam would mean that we try to avoid those situations where we are likely to get more distracted. Maybe don't sit near the door because then everybody coming in and going out, we will be distracted by that. So this is simply anukulya sankalpa pratikulya varjanam in the activity of hearing. So we surrender to Krishna during the limb of hearing, and most of this can be applied even to chanting, by making these choices. In many ways, this among the six limbs of surrender, the beginning points are actually more practical for us. See, when we sit for either studying Shastra or doing our Japa, how much our mind will focus, that is often not in our control. We may try, some days we feel absorbed in chanting and some days we feel obsessed by something else. And then we feel as if, when will this chanting end? Some days we feel that chanting japa should never end. We feel so connected, we feel so empowered, we get such a taste. And some days we feel that japa never ends. It just goes on and on and on. What is this? So basically things work differently at different times. So we can't very easily predict how our mind will feel at some time. But we have, in a sense, much more control over our physical actions than our mental emotions. So anukulya sankalpa pratikulya varjanam is more about those practical actions. So even when we don't feel surrendered, we can act surrendered. And that acting surrendered is by choosing what is favorable and avoiding what is unfavorable. So I'll talk about this in three terms, favorable, unfavorable. Basically, we use the word adibhautik, adidaivik, and adiatmik. Now, usually we associate the word with klesha, that there is, we could say psychophysical is adiatmik, then social is adibhautik. Of course, adibhauti can also include other living beings. And then, but we can all put that in English in social. And then we could have environmental, that adidaivik. So now from all these three, kleshas can come upon us. But the point is, why these three specifically? because these three are the broad circles in which a soul is embedded in the world. We are spiritual beings, but we are embedded in a particular body and mind. Then we are embedded in a particular social situation, social circle. Say, for example, now we might have a male body or a female body, maybe a South Indian body or a North Indian body or an American body, whatever. And each body-mind machine comes with a particular set of particular nature, particular inclinations. So we could go back to the earlier one, particular instincts and impulses. And similarly, we are in a particular social circle. So we might be having neighbor. We might be in the neighbors who are completely anti-spiritual. Relatives might be a little bit pro-spiritual. Family members might be neutral or positive, or maybe equally more enthusiastic than us also. So we can have this social circle can also vary in different ways. And then there is the environment. So some places where it becomes freezing cold, you know, waking up in the morning may seem almost impossible. It may be so unbearably difficult. Or doing any kind of morning sadhana or anything, it may be very, very difficult in particular places. In other places, it might not be that difficult. So basically, these three circles affect us in various ways. And we can try to change certain things in each of these circles. We cannot change everything, but the anukulyasa sankalpa pratikulyasa varjanam would mean that in each of these, we try to choose what is favorable and avoid that which is unfavorable. Essentially, every action that we do, it actually interacts with one or more or all of these circles. It interacts with all, but it is significantly affected. Sometimes, say for example, we might be very healthy and we might not even notice our body and mind. Our body is fit, our mind is clear. And then when we want to do something, when the environment is clear or when any of these circles are clear, then it's like a transparent mirror or a transparent window rather, sorry. When there's a transparent window, we don't even notice the window. We just notice what is being seen outside. So sometimes our social circle is clear. What we want to do, everybody is encouraging us. Everybody is warm to us. So then we don't even notice that much. It's not an obstacle. And sometimes the weather may be very sparkling and friendly and enlivening. Sometimes it may not be. So basically, when we act in these three circles, we need to act in a way that is favorable for our relationship with Krishna, and we need to avoid the actions that are unfavorable for our relationship with Krishna. Let's consider the example here of Bali Maharaj. The Bali Maharaj's social circle, let's focus on that. In that particular situation, it was social circle that mattered the most, not the environmental or not the psychophysical. In his social circles, essentially, he was surrounded by demons. And he had a Brahmana guru to whom he was very indebted because in the 8th canto, it is described in 10th, 11th chapters that Bali Maharaj actually was killed by Indra. But then Shukracharya used his mystical Brahmanical powers to again to bring him back to life. And when he came back to life, after that, he had him do the Vishwajita Yajna. And based on that, he defeated Indra and conquered the heavens. So his life and his possessions, everything he had got by the virtue of Shukracharya. And then at that time, what happened to him? Vamana came as a Brahmana seeking charity. Now, if you consider here, Vamana is a Brahmana and Shukracharya is also a Brahmana. And if you consider Vamana is much younger, he's just like a child over there. He's a dwarf. not only physically he is small in size, but age-wise also Vamana is considered to be like a small, not a very old man. Certainly not a middle-aged man also. He's not even a young man, he's a boy. And that's why he is called as Upendra. Upa in Sanskrit means sub or below. So Upadhyaksha. Adhyaksha is the chief. Upadhyaksha is the deputy chief. So deputy person. So Upendra means the younger brother of Indra. But actually we could take it in the, like Vyajastuti is the same word can be explained in different ways. That's one of the ways of analyzing. And in the Bhagavatam, sometimes Indra is criticizing Krishna, and Vishnu Achyutakura explains how that criticism is actually a praise. So Pandita Maninaha, he says that Balisha Stabda, he thinks himself very clever. Pandita Maninaha. But Chakravarti Pasa, this actually also means Pandita Manina. He is given man even by the Panditas. Similarly, Upendra, we could, in Sanskrit, Upendra. If you take it in English, it will mean Up Indra. The one who is situated up above Indra. That he is the person who is the supreme being. Indra is just the highest among the gods, among the administrative gods. He's the king. But Indra is Vamana is much above that. But at least at this point, Upendra, who is Vamana, is just an ordinary Brahmana. At least extraordinary in the sense that he has great effulgence, great charm. But Bali has not interacted with him before. Bali sees him for the first time. So Shukracharya is a Brahmana who is time tested, who has done incredible things for him. And Vamana has come to him, who has never done anything for him. Vamana is going to ask him for something. So among these two, whom should he choose? Now, common sense might say that obviously he should stay with the time-tested Brahmana. And this Brahmana also gives him reasons. Although you have said that you will give him charity, but you shouldn't right now, because he will take everything away from him. And he also says that, okay, based on Shastra, sometimes when your life is a threat, you needn't honor your word. And this is a case like that. So now in this case, his latent devotion gradually will manifest. And that's why he's considered an exemplar. Example is like something which illustrates. Exemplar is when some person illustrates that. It's called exemplar. So he's an exemplar of surrender, because in one sense he gives up so much for so little. He gives up the counsel of a time-tested Brahmana for an untested Brahmana. He gives up his kingdom he's ready to give up everything just to honor his word. And ultimately, he gives up his own head, which means he actually subordinates himself to offer himself in a mood of devotion. So we could say that when he does it, it's an extraordinary example of surrender. But what happens before surrender is he's choosing. So anukulya sankalpa. So he says that if it is Vishnu who has come to take something from me, then giving to Vishnu is actually a great fortune. So his initially his calculations are like a Kshatriya who is very charitable, but because he has had Prahlad Maharaj as his grandfather, and Prahlad has instilled bhakti impressions within him. So at this time of emergency, the bhakti impressions come out. And with these bhakti impressions coming out, he actually becomes absorbed in Krishna, and he offers himself. So anukulya sankalpa. So here, offering himself to giving his own head for the third step of Vamana is anukulya, and he does that. And he feels that although it is his priest, it is the Brahmana who is also in one sense his guru, who is telling him don't give, that is pratikulyasya. So he refuses that pratikulyasya varjana. Now I give this specific example because the Bhagavatam says that when Shukracharya told him don't give anything to this Brahmana, It is said in the Bhagavatam that Bali Maharaj thought about it. And after due contemplation, he came to this decision. So whereas earlier we talked about instincts and impulses, now that is something which we do without thinking. This choosing the favorable and rejecting the unfavorable is something which we do with due thought. So what is required for us to be able to accept the favorable and avoid the unfavorable? So pratikulyasya varjanam. Varjanam means to put aside. Now the word reject has nowadays an increasingly negative connotation. And especially rejection is used when the relationship breaks up, whether it is before the relationship is formalized or after it is formalized. So the word reject often has a strongly negative connotation. So I tend to avoid using that word. It's avoidance that we can use also. So pratikulyasya varjanam. Varjanam means to put aside, to avoid, to leave. Mm-hmm. when we varjana, is that not necessarily that thing is bad, but it is not favorable for me. So we see that when Bali does not do Shukracharya's bidding, he doesn't condemn Shukracharya saying that you are misleading me. He just gives his reasoning and he moves on. So when we are accepting something and when we are avoiding something, there is the understanding that some things are unhealthy. So we say, there's a saying in the Bible, which we often quote, hate the sin, not the sinner. So it's interesting, the focus here is not the sinner, don't hate the sinner. But then, should we hate the sin? Hate is a very strong emotion. The point of hating means we have to be understand that certain actions have certain consequences and certain actions at best be avoided. And we keep a healthy distance from them. So varjanam is in that sense that some things which are unfavorable, we stay away from them. So we could have four possibilities. Some people who are completely thoughtless, they may love the sin and love the sinner. So they will completely be dragged down. That means if what they are doing is they are pratikulyasya sankalpa and anukulyasya varjanam. They'll be doing that. But some people might go to the other extreme, and if you consider four quadrants, yes, sin and sinner. So hate the sin and hate the sinner. And somebody would love the sin and love the sinner. Well, we should care for those who are wrong or those who are even taking us in the wrong direction. But we cannot love that wrong thing. So Karana was associated with Duryodhana, and he loved Duryodhana and started loving Duryodhana's nefarious actions also. So much so that he started doing them more than Duryodhana. It was Karana who suggested that Draupadi be disrobed. So love the sin and love the sinner will also drag us down. Then the third quadrant could be, we hate the sinner and love the sin. This is hypocritical. So some people, they publicly condemn anyone who does something wrong. But privately, they do the same thing themselves because they are attached to it. So that's hypocritical. But what is best is compassionate is to be compassionate is hate the sin and love the sinner. So basically, the point I'm making over here is this: accepting the favorable and avoiding the unfavorable. It requires a proper understanding of philosophy so that we can differentiate between what is favorable and what is unfavorable. Now we also say that sankalpa and vikalpa are the functions of the mind, accepting and rejecting. So, but here also in surrender, it is said you have to accept something and reject something. So what is the difference? The difference is that when the mind accepts or rejects, the mind does it instinctively. That the mind just, whatever it feels like doing, it does it. Whatever it feels like, I don't want to do it, it doesn't do it. So that it's driven primarily by emotions. And devotion is too important a thing to be left to our emotion. Devotion is too important a thing to be left to our emotion. Just like if we consider, if we have a job or if we have family responsibilities. Sometimes we feel like doing it, sometimes we may not feel like doing it. But if you understand it's important for us, and we do it no matter how we feel. So something similar with respect to devotion, it's too important to be left to our emotion. So the mind accepts and rejects simply based on its feelings. Whereas for this anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam, we need to use our intelligence to know what is favorable and what is unfavorable. And how do we know this? I talked earlier about, say, three things. If you consider there is, how do I put it? There is instincts and intelligence. Sorry, instincts and impulses which are done without conscious intelligence. Instincts are like programmed intelligence. We are intelligent, but we don't consciously think about it. And impulses are programmed anti-intelligent. Program unintelligent. There are these two forces, and above them is our conscious intelligence. So basically, surrender requires us to choose what is favorable and avoid what is unfavorable. That means now the instincts and impulses we have, that's what we already have. So some of us may have impulse towards, say, as soon as some Facebook update comes up, I just want to look at it. Now, we want to control it, but it may take some time to control it. We might have some virtuous instincts. Say, whenever we are traveling by a train or a car, if we see a temple, we just fold our hands in front or just bow our head a little bit. If we touch our foot to someone, in a way, we offer our respects. These are all instincts which are good at some level. So, anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam requires primarily the conscious intelligence to be functioning. So now this brings us to the point which I think of surrender as a very devotional activity. But the devotional also is based, for the devotional, the philosophical is foundational. It's like if you are to drive on a road, it is the driving that will take us to the destination. Just having a map alone won't take us to the destination. Our Google map may tell, GPS may tell us the full way. But it is, we have to drive. So while driving, two things are required. First, we need the map, and then we need to drive according to the map. So the map, having the map, is what scriptural study does for us. Just having the map is not enough. Scriptural knowledge has to be applied, not just studied. So, anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam, it's going back to the driving example now. Right? If I have a map which tells me, okay, this route will take you half an hour more. This route will save half an hour. So, we have that information and then we use it to choose the shortest route. So, similarly, a map is what enables us to choose, and scripture is like a map for us. So scriptural knowledge gives our intelligence the overall map, the overall framework within which we can make the choices of what is favorable and of accepting the favorable and avoiding the unfavorable. So it is purpose that brings perspective. When we study scripture, what is the purpose? Now, when we can go into the fifth canto cosmology, and it's so complicated, this dimension, this loka, that loka. If we consider what is the Bhagavatam's purpose in studying that or describing that, Parikshit Maharaj has 7 days remaining. And Parikshit Maharaj doesn't have the time at that time to do a PhD in cosmology. He is interested in focusing his mind on Krishna. That's what he has renounced the world for. And that's what Shukadeva Goswami is speaking for. So the point is, fix the mind on Krishna. And during that time, that was the Bhagavatam's worldview. It seems to have been familiar. And so that is described by Shukadeva Goswami. And that description is used so that he can remember Krishna within his existing knowledge of cosmology. Now, today, most of us have grown up in the modern education system, and we have grown up with a very different conception of the universe. If somebody is specifically interested in cosmology, they can focus on trying to analyze, compare, contrast, reconcile the Bhagavatam's cosmology and the modern cosmology. But for most devotees, they've not come to Shastra to study cosmology. They've come to Shastra to learn how to remember Krishna, how to become better devoted to Krishna, how to bring meaning and value into our life. So then, we can focus primarily when we study the Bhagavatam. If we look at the reports of Srila Prabhupada on the fifth canto, he's not going into the technicalities, the descriptions too much. Even in his purports, he's giving the principles of spiritual life rather than specifics of the universal manifestation or the manifestations of the universe. So I was discussing with Bhurjan Prabhu in Perth about this fifth canto cosmology and how to make it intelligible to rational people today. So he said that he has done a careful study of that, and that basically, if you consider the thought flow of the Bhagavatam, that fifth canto starts with detachment, with how Bharat Maharaj is giving instructions to Maharaj Rishabhdev is giving instructions to his sons. And then after that, we have the whole story of Bharat Maharaj and everything. So basically, the point is that how important it is to be detached from the world and to be attached to the Lord. And the whole universe is described from that perspective, how everybody in every part of the universe is doing dharma and devotion, how they are either they are attached to the Lord or they are moving toward becoming attached to the Lord. And that's what we should also do. The thrust of the Bhagavatam is not to describe cosmology. The thrust of the Bhagavatam is to show how throughout the cosmos there is devotion. Therefore, we should also practice devotion. So for us, if there is too much confusion in some philosophical point, this doesn't make sense. How do I make sense? Then if it's not a central point for us for fixing the mind on Krishna, then we might just put it in the ballpark, in the car park. That means, okay, maybe in the future I'll understand this. Let me put this aside and move on toward those things which nourish my relationship with Krishna. So even in studying Shastra, we have to adopt this approach. Anukulyasya sankalpa, pratikulyasya varjanam. Accept that which is favorable and avoid that which is unfavorable. And Prabhupada does this quite pragmatically. That now in scripture, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has written a beautiful essay on the Bhagavad, which he wrote for the Bhadraloka of his times. I spoke about this earlier also when I spoke on Bhaktivinoda Thakur's appearance. So he basically helps people to navigate the Bhagavatam through whatever part of the Bhagavatam might be troublesome. So he says the cosmological and the chronological aspects of the Bhagavatam, they are basically the setting. But the essential thing is the Leela of Krishna, the Smaran of Krishna, the Bhakti for Krishna. It's like, say, sometimes we are watching a drama of the Ramayana or of Krishna Leela. Now, we might have a certain setting for Krishna Leela in our mind, or this is how Vrindavan is. And somebody might, in a particular drama, depict Vrindavan in a slightly different way. Now, the important thing is that whether Krishna Leela is being accurately depicted, the setting for Vrindavan is important, no doubt. But you will see that, see, the way ISKCON art is, which the Prabhupada encouraged to make, it is much more realistic. Much of the Krishna depiction, especially if you consider in Jaipur and Vrindavan also, it's Rajasthani art. And that is slightly different. So the setting is important, but more important than the setting is the essence of what, the substance of what is being depicted. Similarly, for either way, the point of studying the world is not to understand the world. The point of studying the world is to understand that we need to go beyond the world. I write on the Gita every day, so there's a Gita Daily article I wrote called "The Point of the World is to Point Beyond the World." The point of the world exists to point us to a reality beyond the world. That reality is Krishna. So today, if we find the Bhagavatam's cosmology very difficult to understand, we could consider today's cosmology. And the important thing is that we move toward Krishna. For many thoughtful people, even for many scientists, even the vastness of the cosmos as discovered by science also points to a cosmogonal intelligence. So these are different models. Just like Ayurveda and Allopathy can have different models of the body. And both work in their own ways for treating the body. Similarly, Bhagavatam and science can have different models of the universe. But if both of them are promoting God consciousness for us as seekers, then we can adopt whichever one helps us the most. So in the study of scripture, we need to have this, if you want to stay focused, anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya vachan. Otherwise, we can get so caught in small, small trivialities. And Prabhupada was asked one time by devout disciples in Hawaii, that how do we explain to scholars the phenomenal numbers in the Bhagavatam? For example, Maharaj Ugrasen is said to have an astronomical number of bodyguards. So if you tell this to scholars, they start laughing. They say, how could so many people live in the island of Dwarka? Where were their quarters? Where were their restrooms? It's not possible. Now, Prabhupada could have said that Krishna can maintain the whole universe on the tip of a needle. But Prabhupada chooses not to fight that battle. Prabhupada said, among all the sections of the Bhagavatam, was that the only thing you found to speak to the scholars? A very profound question. Was that the only thing you found to speak to the scholars? That means we have to consider what is anukul for them to develop appreciation for the Bhagavatam? What is anukul, what is favorable for them to come closer to Krishna by their study of the Bhagavatam? And Prabhupada said, focus on that. We have the principles of spiritual life, which are universal. How bhakti is the way of approaching the divine through love. That is so appealing. So why focus on things which are not that important? In the study of scripture, anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam. Same we can apply in our association. Some devotees tend to be very, very critical. Everything about the Krishna conscious movement, they say, oh, this is bad, that is bad, that is bad. Well, yes, the Krishna conscious movement is in the material world. And in the material world, everything is contaminated. So we see the Krishna consciousness movement also like a multi-level manifestation. A multi-level manifestation means depending on our consciousness, whether it is in tamoguna, rajoguna, sattvaguna, or shuddha sattva, we'll see the Krishna consciousness movement differently. So if we are primarily in tamoguna, tamoguna is characterized by, say, fighting and passivity. Sometimes we just hyperactively fight and other times we just become apathetic. So if we are tamasic, then we will see that, devotees keep having quarrels, devotees keep fighting, there are so many groups. It's so pathetic. Why do devotees quarrel? We are all saying, I want to serve Krishna, but you keep quarreling. Yes, there are differences everywhere. And there are differences in the material world also. And because Krishna conscious movement is there in the material world, it will exploit those people who have the mode of ignorance in their minds. And this is what they will see. And they'll say this is just a group of people who keep quarreling. They can't get along with among themselves also. Somebody in Rajoguna will see the Krishna consciousness movement as something which is a way to power and prestige and wealth. And I'll say that, so if that person is active, then they will think, oh, here I can get, I can do this, I can do that, I can become famous, I can become popular. Or somebody may say, this is what all the leaders are looking for. This is what they all want. Everybody wants prestige, everybody wants power, everybody wants followers. Somebody in Satvaguna, they will see that actually, this is a place where if I come, I can live a better life. I can have like-minded, uplifting people. I can hear some wisdom. I can purify my heart. And whatever be the blemishes over here, the quality of my life can be better in the association of devotees in the movement rather than outside. Provided, of course, I associate properly. But that's what a devotee will focus on. If the devotee is sattva and is serious about spirituality. If a devotee is beyond sattva, the devotee will see, oh, there are so many exalted devotees over here. Their association is so precious. Let me associate with them. So now when we are practicing Krishna consciousness in a particular movement, then we have to very carefully apply this anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjana. That if we start looking at everything that is wrong, yes, there are many things that are wrong. Krishna is Kalpataru. And Krishna's movement is also Kalpataru. So Kalpataru means whatever we want, we will get it. So if we want prestige, we will get prestige in Krishna's movement. We just wait around, become a little senior, and then as soon as we come, people start offering obeisances to us. That's quite gratifying to the ego, if that's what we are looking for. If we want followers, if we just know how to pretend to be advanced, even if you're not advanced, we can attract followers. If we want controversy, we can get as much controversy as we might find in the gossip columns of mundane newspapers. That much we can find on sites by people who are disgruntled devotees. And we can live in controversy. You know, this happened over here, this happened there. So we can get controversy, we can get prestige, we can get following, and we can get Krishna also. So Krishna, in the Krishna consciousness movement, it is a matter of changing our consciousness. So if we want Krishna, we will get Krishna. But if we're conscious of other things, that's what we will focus, that's what we'll get. So in the movement also, we have to apply this anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjana. That we associate with those who uplift our consciousness. We focus on those things that are favorable for our relationship with Krishna. And that way, we all can move forward in our devotional journey. So, here, accepting the favorable and rejecting the unfavorable is something which is very proactive and has to be responsibly done. And this resourceful, responsible choice is the active part of surrender. And tomorrow we'll move on toward more the consciousness underlying surrender. And we'll talk about the dispositions. But I'll summarize today. So I spoke about how to understand surrender in terms of its first two elements. Anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjana. Accept the favorable, avoid the unfavorable. I started by talking about how in every situation we do apply it. We choose something and we avoid some things. And we do it sometimes based on our instincts, which are like programmed intelligence, or on our impulses, which are like programmed unintelligent impressions within us. But we want to act with conscious intelligence. That's what is recommended as a part of surrender over here. And to develop their conscious intelligence, we need to study scripture carefully. So scripture is like a map, whatever map is for a driver. So just studying scripture doesn't take us to destination. Just as looking at the map doesn't take a driver to destination. But studying scripture or having a map is essential for driving to the destination, for making the choices that will take us closer to Krishna. And I talked about how we have to act within the world first give example. Simply when we come to a class, whom we sit next to or what position we sit can determine whether we are able to hear nicely or not. And that itself is applying anukulesa sankalpa pratikulesa varchanam. So the soul exists in three broad circles, the psychophysical, the social, and the environmental. And in each of these circles, we need to choose what is favorable for our relationship with Krishna and avoid that which is unfavorable. For the story of Bali Maharaj was analyzed primarily to show how he gave up the time test to Shukracharya and honored his word to the untested Vamana because he chose what was favorable for his relationship with the ultimate reality, Vishnu. And because he gave up so much for so little, that's one reason why he's an emblem of self-surrender to the Lord. Then I talked about applying this principle of accepting the favorable and rejecting the unfavorable to the way we look at the philosophy and we look at the Krishna conscious movement. At scripture, the focus of scripture, the purpose is to help Parikshit Maharaj and us to fix the mind on Krishna. So some things within scripture are not so easily understandable or they disturb us. Then we need to keep them in the ballpark and move onwards in our relationship with Krishna. So what is central in scripture is not the cosmology or the chronology. Central is the spirituality, the remembrance of Krishna. And that's what we need to focus on also. And whatever is favorable for the development of our relationship with Krishna, for some people with intellectual or scientific inclinations, they might want to do an intricate study and that might be favorable of cosmology. But for most, it may not be. So then I talked about in our association when we have to select, I talked about four kinds of people, four kinds of attitudes. To hate the sin and hate the sinner. That is being judgmental. To love the sin and to love the sinner is being sentimental. To hate the sinner and love the sin is being hypocritical. And to hate the sin and love the sinner is being spiritual, is being devotional. So to understand what to avoid and what to not avoid, we need our intelligence to be sharp. And with that sharp intelligence, we can also, in the association of devotees, look at what is favorable for us within the movement. The movement can be seen as a place of quarrels and conflicts when we are in the mode of ignorance and we are looking for that. The movement, it can be seen as the place for pursuing prestige and wealth and following, if we are in the mode of passion, as a place for living a more meaningful and purposeful life, adding more value to our life, if we are in the mode of goodness, and as a place for associating those who are close to Krishna and moving ourselves close to Krishna, if we are in transcendence. So in association, if we choose our association carefully and focus on that which is favorable, then we can purposefully move toward Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Are there any questions? Yes, Mataji. So was that a comment or was that a question? Okay. Yeah, thank you. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Shall we stop here then? Yes, Mataji.
So the question is,
Yes. So sometimes we keep making mistakes in terms of choosing or doing something which is unfavorable and not doing that which is favorable. So how do we, if we keep doing it repeatedly, how do we overcome that? So basically we begin with what we can do. Right now itself, you know, you might be able to list maybe three things which are doable, which are good for, which are favorable for a relationship with Krishna, which are doable. Maybe I can, whatever, I read 5 minutes more Bhagavatam every day. If I'm reading 0 minutes, I can read 5 minutes. If I'm reading 10 minutes, I can read 15 minutes. Something, we can just list things which are doable for us and start with them. And we can list some things which are unfavorable and which we can do. Say I spend 1 hour on social media, maybe I'll spend 45 minutes. Whatever, something simple. So we need to begin somewhere. And sometimes some conditionings are deep-rooted. So if we define our devotion by our ability to overcome those conditionings, then we will feel so discouraged that we will feel as if we are not advancing at all. So the same thing somebody else might be able to give up very easily, but we might struggle to give up because each of us has different conditionings. So say this is indulgence, this is abstinence, and that it might be a straight path to walk for somebody from indulgence to abstinence. That means I'm indulging and I give it up. But for somebody else, the conditioning might be so much that in between indulgence and abstinence, there is a big mountain to be climbed. And it is so exhausting to climb that mountain. So I'm going to talk in Atmanikshepa Karpanya. I want to talk about self-acceptance. We talked about how we need to choose what is favorable, but we also need to choose what is a favorable conception of ourselves, a favorable relationship with ourselves. Now we can be an unfavorable attitude, which you often talk about, is that the thing that we are greater, we are better than what we are. To think that we are pure when we are not pure, to think that we are advanced when we are not advanced. But another could be that to just think of oneself so negatively, you know, I'm worthless, I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't do that. Humility is not a self-flagellation. Self-flagellate is to beat. Self-flagellation is constantly beating oneself down for being worthless. That is not humility. Humility essentially means we stop thinking about ourselves and we start thinking about Krishna more and more. So self-obsession can be because I think I'm so great, or self-obsession can be also I think I'm so fallen. But either way, if we are self-conscious, then we can't be conscious of Krishna. So that optimal understanding of ourselves, so that we are neither negatively self-obsessed nor positively self-obsessed. That's what we need. So we have to accept, okay, this particular conditioning may take a long time for me to overcome, but let me work on what I can do. And as we keep doing those things which we can, accepting the favorable wherever we can and avoiding the unfavorable wherever we can, begin with that, gradually our spiritual strength will grow. We will become purer by that. And gradually things we are not able to do, we'll also start doing that. So begin with where we are and take, even if small, but tangible steps from there. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yes. Okay, it's a long question. I think it's already 12. I'll answer this very briefly today, but maybe tomorrow you can ask this question again and I can answer it more. So how do we separate the sin from the sinner? Basically, we all have to know what is our capacity. That means if a person is drowning, they can't save somebody else. And if somebody is too heavy and we swim to try to save them, then we will also drown by that. That means in some cases, if somebody's nature is such that it triggers too much negative emotion within us, then even the effort to try to see them positively will only increase the negativity within us. So sometimes some amount of distance may be what is required. If some natures are such that they don't match at all, then we first may need a certain amount of distance so that our consciousness doesn't get that agitated. And in some, that means in some cases, some people have done such terrible things, or not necessarily terrible, they act in ways which are so unpleasant for us that just seeing those actions makes us forget every philosophy, all philosophy and everything. So then we may need to create a distance, because we can't make our mind and its emotions our slaves. They will be what they are. And if the emotions are going wild, we keep a little distance from them, to that person. Now, this, they're not the ultimate solution, but that might be initially what is required. But over a period of time, we understand that just as we have a mind which troubles us, and which makes us do things which we do not want to do, others also have a mind. And what we call as people's nature is what comes from their mind. Just as we struggle to separate our mind from us and we are misled by our mind, so others also get misled by their minds. So if we see their mind, their nature as coming from their mind, not their soul, then rather than thinking that we are fighting, that they are attacking us or they are troubling us, we see that we are all fighting the same battle. Just that their mind troubles them in a different way, our mind troubles us in a different way. But we are all battling against the mind. So just ascribing their nature to their mind helps us create some amount of camaraderie, comradeship. Now, of course, we may say, I am struggling to control my mind, but this person is not even struggling to control their mind. They're simply acting according to their nature. Yes, practically, if some people act in ways that are too hurting for us, better keep a distance. But if we can see this way, that it's their mind that is making them do such a thing, then rather than thinking, why are you doing this? When we say, why do you act like this? That means we are equating them with their mind. But instead, we become more empathic and, you know, when this kind of situation comes, what kind of thoughts come in your mind? What do you feel at that time? And then if we understand that, oh, okay, this is how their mind is thinking. This is how their mind is making them perceive the situation. And then we can help them to say that actually the reality is not like this. So basically the essential answer would be that just we need to separate the hate the sin and not the sinner means see the sin as coming from the impelling by the mind. And see the soul as separate from it. Nadatte kasachit papam na chaiva sukrutam vibhav. Agyane navratam jnanam tena mohiyanti jantava. Agyane navratam jnanam. Because of the ignorance and illusion in the mind, people act in ways that are hurtful. So how we will practically deal with it, that will depend on the nature of our relationship with them, how close we are, the hierarchy in the relationship, whether we are guiding them or they are in authority position for us, and the how important is that relationship? Do we need to work with them always? Based on that, we'll have to come up with different specific strategies of how to at least we separate them from their mind, and then we equip them to separate themselves from their mind, and then gradually we can come to a more effective working or an intimate relationship with them. Does that answer your question? So, thank you very much. Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Gaur Bhakta Vinda Ki Jai, Itai Gaur Premanande, Hari Hari Bo. Namo Namaha.